We all want life. We want a quality of life that really matters. Followers of Jesus wanted that too, so they left everything and followed him. They watched him love the outcast, confront the religious elite, and proclaim the kingdom of God to anyone who would listen. And then they watched him die. But just when all hope was lost, they watched him rise again. And somewhere along the way, they discovered what they'd been searching for all along. They discovered abundant life. So what about us? We've become exhausted by temporal things that promise meaning and purpose, but in the end, deliver nothing. What we really want, what we really crave, is life. The very life that Jesus walked out of the tomb to invite us into. How do we discover what we've been searching for all along? May God give us eyes to see.
Well, this is the conclusion of our series, Jesus, the Way, the Truth, and the Life. And we've really looked at his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection and ascension. And this statement, such clarity he gives us so we can understand who he is, when in John chapter 14, verse 6, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. We've discovered that with Jesus, all things are possible, that he is the fullness of God, that if you were ever curious about what God would be if he was a human, it's Jesus. Because of that, he can reconcile all things. It gives us great hope that no matter how bad it looks, he has the ability and the ministry of reconciliation to reconcile all things. But also with Jesus, it's very personal, that he is just not far off, that he wants a personal relationship with us. The MR in Masters Road, as you guys know, we're starting a church in Montana this summer called the Church on Mission Ridge. There's these Mission Ridge mountains, and the guys up there say, man, we love your church, we've been following y'all, and the area here needs a church like that, and they want to be called the Church on Mission Ridge, and we're going to keep that MR logo, and we're going to help them, and then as they get launched and become their own church. Really excited about this summer. Really came just from a mission trip of going, man, let's start a church. But the MR, I remember people would come early to church and they would go, man, that MR, it stood different things for them. And I remember one time a guy's like, hey, you know what MR stands for, me? I'm like, what? He's like, that's my room. That's just my room where I meet with Jesus. I said, man, that's awesome. But let's have you meet actually in your room. He'll do that. But Jesus says, go to your room, shut the door. But I love what he was trying to say there, you know? But my favorite, when I think it's what? It's my relationship with Jesus. Is there anything more important than my relationship with Jesus, your relationship? Like, that's the fundamental importance of this whole Christianity thing. Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? And you say, no, listen, hey, it's personal. The goal is for us to understand that Jesus plus nothing equals everything. And everything minus Jesus equals nothing. And we hear that when he makes the statement, I am the life. I am the life. He said he's come what? He's come to give life and life abundantly. That, hey, I didn't just come to give life so you can kind of enjoy it and you can kind of eke by and, hey, just get through, raise the kids, have a normal life and just breeze off into eternity. No, he's like, no, that's not the way I designed this thing. He said, I want you to have life and I want it to be so abundant. Like there's fruit popping up everywhere. Like it is an abundant life. And he said, I will give you that. And so the mystery for you and I is going, man, how do we live this abundant life? Would you say that you like your life? Would you say that you love your life? I don't know about you, but when I travel, man, it just excites me. It reminds me, man, there's so many people out there. And as we travel, we're on this journey. We're all on a mission trip. And you know what? The last 5 or 6 years, I've just noted there is a lot of sad people out there. They're just sad. I mean, the place we're at, the lady giving the towels out. I mean, you're working at a resort. All you got to do is hand out a towel, and you're depressed. How can you be depressed handing out towels? Why? Because there's something underneath there. But no plan or purpose. The guy at Mod Pizza. Mod Pizza's a great place. That's a pretty good pizza for about $9 or $10. You put anything you want. There's a Subway of pizza. And I'm getting there. And this guy, he's so upset about his pizza. I'm like, you're about to eat pizza. What are you so depressed about? What are you sad about? Pizza makes me feel better. And you're depressed by the pizza you ordered. You ordered it. Why are you so upset? Why? Because they're not happy. They don't have a joy. They don't have Jesus in their life. And when we can say, listen, it is well with my soul. I don't, if I'm going through suffering, if I'm going through pain, it's okay. I know who I am. And what? I love my life. Why? Because I have someone who's leading me and guiding me and knows what's best for my life. Anyways, here's what I want to do tonight, Galatians. I think this passage is really important for us as we kind of finish up the series here. This is Galatians chapter 4. I'm going to read verse 5. It says, to redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. Paul is writing to the early church here. And this is going to be a circular letter. It goes throughout. And what's happening is there are people receiving the message of Christ. Praise God. And that's what it says. What? It says to redeem those who were under the law. That you're no longer under the law. You've been what? Redeemed. And redemption is required. If you call yourself a Christian, you must be redeemed. What does redeem mean? It's to gain or regain possession of something in exchange of a payment. And what Christ did on the cross, he redeemed, he paid a penalty, he to tell us die that our sin and your, so that we could have a freedom, that he redeemed us, he restored us, he regained, recovered, reclaimed. It's a redemption story. And I hope you have that story. Because, listen, you're not born good. That's what the world says, everybody's born good. No, you're born evil, you're born wretched. You don't have to teach any kid to do wrong. We're not good inherently. We've sinned, we've all fallen short. And what happens is we get to exchange this filthy, wretched life of sin. And because of what Christ did on the cross, we can have the Holy Spirit living in us and we have access to the abundant life. That we have to be redeemed. Redemption is required. And some of you have been there. You go, man, I'm not going to hell, praise God. Right? You're like, man, hey, I humbled myself. I have been redeemed. I'm not going to hell. And that's about where it left off. We had 29 people get baptized a few months ago. And what's important? Hey, guys, I want to get everybody back together. I want to get everybody back together. Get them back together because the temptation will be what? That's it. I got saved. And no one talked. I don't know what to do next. And that's what my lot was, to get saved. And what's this pastor said? No. So that we might receive adoption as sons. The real goal here is what? Adoption. Adoption is the achievement. You've been redeemed so that. Some of you are getting an education so that you can have a better job. Just pray with the lady. Has a test tomorrow, right? Why? Well, so that I can do that. We understand that. There is cause and effect. He says, listen, the whole reason you were redeemed is so that what? Adoption can be achieved. Many of you are connected to the adoption process, understand. In fact, we just joined another ministry as one of our Act Now partners called The Sanctuary. Exciting what we're going to be able to do in that world, in this area. And if you're interested in adoption and foster, we're going to have plenty of opportunity to be a part of that. But if you've been a part of those adoption ceremonies, what's the best part? What's the best part when they get in front and they say what? Welcome to your forever family. And that's the goal of every believer, that you and I would understand what? We have been adopted into this family, and we have a forever family, that you and I can understand our identity as a son and a daughter. And this is where most people get it wrong. They understand redemption, they understand salvation, but they never understand adoption and what it means. But why does Christ use the term adoption all throughout the New Testament? In first century world, if you could disown your own kids, but if you adopted someone, you could never disown them. And he says what? You've been given the spirit of adoption. Once you're mine, you're never not mine. Redemption without adoption is half the gospel. Redemption without adoption is just half the gospel. And this is why so many people are confused. They only know half the gospel, the redemption part. But they haven't achieved, understand what? Their true identity through adoption. Look at verse 6. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba. Isn't this interesting? You've achieved adoption, and the signal, the sign of that, is that the Spirit of God is living inside you, what? And in your heart, you're crying, what? Father. Now, some of you are familiar with the word Abba, the word that Jesus used. It means daddy. And there's a difference, isn't there? Isn't there a difference between daddy and father? You remember when you were a kid, you go to someone else's house, and they would call their dad, Father? You're like, that ain't a good relationship. Father, may I have some time with you? I don't know why I'm using that accent. I don't even know what that is, but. Right, so stiff. Father, mount the horses. Okay, what are we doing here? What is this father business? Don't call me father, call me dad. And Jesus modeled this. He said it's in our heart, what, to have a personal relationship with God, that you go, daddy, you cry out to him. Man, it's amazing to me, and moms are better at this than dads. Man, moms know the cries of their kid. They know if it's a hungry cry, if it's a tired cry. They know if it's an in danger cry. They'll drop everything and come running. And he says that's the relationship. In fact, if you study the word Abba in the Hebrew, Hebrew is very concrete. You know what Abba means? It's breathing. It's breathing in and breathing out. He says, listen, my relationship with you is so intimate. It's every breath that you're saying my name, that we are so connected that you would call me Abba. And that's why Jesus so often went up to be with Abba. And he said, these are not my words, but they're his words. Why? Because when you spend time with Abba, you sound like him and you begin to speak like him. Our hearts want something personal. Abba is not only our cry. Abba is our confidence. Do you see there in verse 7? So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Do you see what's happening here? He's going, because you're a son, you're an heir. You're a king's kid. You can walk around with confidence, can't you? Why? Because your daddy owns the whole place. He owns everything. There ain't nowhere you can walk and go, man, my daddy doesn't own this and in charge of this. He's in charge of everything. And he's saying, would you start seeing yourself, what, as an heir, as a son and a daughter, and what he's done for you is yours. Go live abundantly. Don't doubt that what your relationship in the family is. It's not based on performance. It's based on position. You are a son and daughter, and he will always love you. Kelly and I were talking about this weekend, and I just told Kelly, I'm confident that you love me. And she says, I'm confident that you love me. Why is that important? I don't go around, does Kelly love me? Does she love me? Does she not? No, she knows me. All the worst, ugly parts about me. What? And she loves me. And we have to communicate the word. I'm confident that you love me. And even when it doesn't feel like her, I'm confident because I'm going to walk around confident that I'm loved by her and I want her to be confident that she's loved by me. Is that how you view God? Are you walking around confidently? I love a confident person. I love someone walks in a room and knows who they are and know who God is. Why? There's a confidence of going, I'm a son and I'm a daughter. And you may look at my shortcomings. And you may look at all my faults. But when my father looks at me, he sees his son, Jesus Christ. And I better learn what it means to be a son of the King and to walk confidently in that relationship. Because he is Abba. Because he is daddy, we're confident people. Verse 9, keep reading, it gets better. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world whose slaves you want to be once more. He says, now that you have come to know God. Think about that for a second. You've now come to know God. What level do you know God? You know, at the church here, I'm way better with faces than names. And I can see, I kind of remember where people sit and all the different services. And until I have a conversation with you, I kind of just know you by your face. And what service you go to and where you sit. And then some of you will stop by pastor's guest reception. And I get to put a name with the face. We'll have a just, you know, kind of chit-chat conversation. Tell me how you heard about the church, where you come from. And I can, okay. And I can begin to try to remember your name. And that way next time I see you, say, oh, hey, how are you doing? Good to see you. And we can begin to have that conversation, right? And then sometimes, like, outside of church, right, we'll see one another. I'm like, oh, hey, how are you doing? Like, hey, I recognize you. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We go to the same church together, right? It's a different level of knowing. And then there's people that that in the church that, man, we've done mission trips together. We serve together. There's just a deeper level of knowing each other. Like, we've been in the trenches with each other. And just, it builds trust. It builds relationship. And you just have a deeper relationship. And there are some people I speak to every single day. Oh, that know me. I know them. And I can see what they're thinking before they say it. They know what I'm thinking before. They know my heart. It's a different level of knowing. And then there's relationship outside of the church, right? Then why? It just becomes deeper and deeper and deeper. When it comes to your relationship with God, how is it? Is it a Sunday thing? Is it a once in the morning thing? What do you know about him? And for some of you, what? It's all day. Always talking to God. Always wondering, pursuing him, and communicating to him. And he's like, some of you are learning what? To know God. What level do you want to know him? Now, can we fully know him? No, I get up every day going, man, I'm learning more. I love it. I want to know God. But look what Paul says. This is so brilliant. He says, actually, I take that back. It's not really, hey, good, I want you to know God, but he says what? You're known by God. Oh, man. Are you catching that? He said, no, it's not that you just know God. You are known by God. God knows everything about you. He knows your heart. He knows your mind. He knows your thoughts. He knows everything you've done. And what does he do? He chooses, that's mine. Come be my son. That's my daughter. Yes, I know you. I know your worst thoughts. I know the worst things you do. But at the end of the day, I love you, and I want you to know you're known by me. Is there anything better in a relationship when they start ordering for you and getting your food right? They know you, how you like your hamburger. I don't know why I'm talking about food so much. I guess I'm hungry. But I'm saying, you know what I'm talking about? It's to be known. You know what kind of clothes and what kind of outfits look good on them? Like, you know them. It's good to be known. I'm really tempted to tell a story over the weekend, but Kelly left and she's coming back, and I don't want you to even mention it. All right, look, here's the thing. Listen, hey. Hey, come on. We've been married 18 years. 18 years, church, okay? Listen, I know her, she knows me, all right? And I'm always trying. I like a surprise. I don't know, there's an element that I always like, and Kelly's very practical. I love that about her. She's so practical, and she takes care of the family and takes care of me, and things are always taken care of. I don't have to worry about anything. She always has a sunscreen. She's just extremely practical. And so, you know, we call these things love trips, okay? All right? So, you know, we love each other. And it's time to exchange some gifts. And Kelly was very thoughtful in her gifts. I want to get into it, you know, because she said, hey, these gifts are for you. I know what you like. And so, hey, enjoy this. And I was appreciative. But I was really excited because I had this idea. Kelly, she carries a lot of stress. And she runs and works every day. And we're just getting older. You know, you're getting older and you start getting sore and cramped, that kind of stuff. And I was like, okay. You know, I got some things for her, but this other thing I really wanted to get, and I can't even tell you. I'm not going to do it. I'm moving on. This is the struggle with this being the first message I speak on Monday night, because I want to say it so bad, but I got to, no, I'm going to honor her. I am, Vicky, the story does honor her. I want you to, it does honor her. It just, I don't think I can get there without her being a little blushed or embarrassed, but it all ended great. okay? And I won't tell you the gift that I got her. So hard. I want to. She was not impressed at first, but I won her over. I won her over, and I'm really excited about that because I know her. I won her over. Why? Because I know her even better than she knows herself sometimes. And I knew she was like, that's not a good idea. I don't like that. And I knew that, and I was prepared for that. But when I rolled up my sleeves and I showed her that she would actually love it, and she loved it. Okay, that's the point. Doesn't matter what it is. That's the point. Nothing better to be known by God. Listen, can I tell you the part about that that's so fun for me? It's not when things are going great. And you're like, man, God's doing this and that. I love that. He knows how to encourage me. He knows how to challenge me. I'm talking about it's the times in my struggle, in my sin, and I'm going, God, I'm just going to be honest with you. God, you know me. You know my heart's prone to wonder. God, you know what's in my heart right now. And God, I know you know that. And thank you for loving me anyways. Thank you for helping me. Thank you, work. God, I know you love me, and I can't believe you love me. It's scary. I can't believe it. But you do. I'm known by you. And what a great feeling. Intimacy is to be fully known without the fear of rejection. To be fully known without the fear of rejection. Rather, to be known by God. And here's the conflict that all of you and I face. Look what it says. How can you turn back again? How can you do it? You gain redemption. You receive the gospel, the message of Christ. You're adopted. You're a son and an heir. There's nothing that's not yours. You have everything the Father. You have eternal life. You have everything you could ever imagine. And he says, but what's happening? You turn back. To what? I love the description here. The weak and worthless elementary principles of the world. The world is weak and empty, isn't it? It is. And Satan will dangle things in front of us. He'll do everything we can to think that we can find pleasure and purpose in these things of the world. But it's weak and empty. At the bottom of the bottle, it's empty, isn't it? All the prescription pills go, and what? It's empty at the bottom. The bank account, sometimes what? It's empty, isn't it? After he or she leaves, the bed is empty. It's empty. The world is weak and it's empty. And what I love, Jesus sympathizes. He says, listen, when you think empty, think of an empty tomb. I want you to know I've defeated death and I've conquered this world. And when you feel empty, you run to that empty tomb because I'm alive. And there's nothing I can't do. There's nothing I can't reconcile. Live the life or deny the life. I'm not on social media because it's depressing. It's depressing for me. There's a couple things that comparison is the thief of joy. I've learned that. And as a church planner, you know, sometimes it's not good to hear everyone's success stories. You know, it's like, oh, we opened up 20 months ago and we got $20 million and we're starting our fifth campus. Ah, oh, praise God, great. Like, I have no one to take care of the kids right now. Like there's no one in there right now, right? And I'm so thankful for where I'm at and what this church has done. And, man, you guys are getting, it's incredible how God's using y'all. And I'm very thankful for every stage we're in. But comparison is a thief of joy at times. But really what gets me is when I see my brothers and sisters in Christ turn back to the world. And I'm like, man, they've been walking with the Lord, I know, for at least a year. Why are they still so attached to that? What is it about that lifestyle that's still appealing to them? Don't they know how empty that is? That's why they came to Christ in the first place. Why are they turning back and doing that? Do they really, that's the best use of their time or their money or their resources? And every now and then it gets kind of bad. And Kel's like, hey, Jason, I got to show you this because you got to know. And she'll show me something. I just weep and I cry. This week it was a bachelorette party with a bunch of alcohol and taking shots. And I'm like, I know them. Really? Like that, when you think that's what you think is a good time? And you know what? I grabbed Kelly and I said, Kelly, you know, I'm going to pray right now. God, I pray in Jesus' name that when Jewel gets, when I get ready to give her off to a man of God one day, I pray that she'll get her bachelorette party would start with serving somebody. That all get together. Hey, let's go serve this ministry. Let's go do this. And all day one, Christ would be in the middle of that. Going, Christ, you saw me through. I'm celebrating with the abundant life is not that. Why does the world say that's the way you got to celebrate? Breaks my heart. Why? Because I know what it's like to go back to those things. Scripture says, like a dog returns to his vomit. So come on. There's redemption, then there's adoption. We're King's kid. We ain't got to live like that. We ain't got to say that. We ain't got to do that. That's not what gives us fulfillment. He says, what? Live the life. Live the life of a daddy that wants to take care of everything for you. I was taking Jewel on her first date. She's about 4 years old. And I just wanted to date her. I wanted her to see what a man, how she should take care of. That way she could identify a counterfeit or a phony quicker. And it was our first date night, and I'll never forget, we had a two-story house at the time, and I came down, and she was waiting at the bottom of the steps, and she had this beautiful dress on, and she had a big old bag of pennies. And she said, Daddy, I'm ready for our date. And I went down there, and I gave her a kiss. I said, sweetheart, when you're with Daddy, you don't need anything. We won't need these. Anything you desire, I'll give it to you. Now, she's a teenager, and I probably should have thought through that a little bit. Because I really have a hard time, you know, saying no. And everyone knows those Lulu clothings are from the devil. Well, how can you charge that much? Anyways, we're working on it. But do you see the principle? Hey, you don't lack for anything, church. You got a daddy that'll take care of all of your needs. He'll take care of everything. Will you let him? Let him. And let's live the life. There's a reason why we spent three weeks on the word the life, because we need to learn to live it and live it abundantly and know who we are and our identity. We are sons and daughters. He owns it all, and he desires to give you the desires of your heart. Amen? Let's pray. God, you're too good, Lord. You're so good to us. God, I thank you for your grace that is just, you're creating new grace upon grace and new mercy for me every single day. And God, I pray in our pursuit to know you that we would know that we're known by you. And God, I know that you love us enough not to keep us where we're at. But God, I thank you that you love us right where we're at. You know my thoughts today. You know my heart's desire. I want to live life abundantly. God, I pray you'd help me. You know my shortcomings. God, I thank you for the joy of being known. God, I pray for just deeper and meaningful relationships. God, I thank you for the people in my life who care and love me and help me navigate this world. God, I pray for our church. God, I just pray for a great band of brothers and sisters in Christ who will walk with each other and help each other live the life and display grace and truth. I know you have good for us. And God, I know the parts of my life or my parenting or my marriage or our ministry that aren't where you want them to be. God, I believe in my heart, I know you can reconcile things and you can redeem things and you can restore things and you can bring dead things to life and you can bring great pleasure through great pain. God, I know that and I believe that. God, I pray for just continued endurance for us to keep living the life with a joy and a peace that passes all understanding. God, I pray when we fall down, we get up quick and we keep going, running after that. You're a good master. And we don't want to be a slave to you, but we want you to be our master. We want to be a slave to you, that we would follow you even when it's hard and when it's difficult. Now we just say we want more. And I thank you that life is found in you. God, I pray you'd help us with our habits and our hobbies and our hearts and all those things that so easily can just be enticed to other things that are sometimes good things. They're just not godly things. They're just not the right thing for us at that moment. God, we don't want to be delayed in our abundant life or delayed in our fulfillment because we're still finding pleasure and enjoyment from our former life. God, I thank you that we can call you Abba, Daddy. God, I thank you for the confidence that we can have in you. Even when we're unsure, we can be sure in you. There's a foundation, there's a confidence that when we get it wrong, you can make it right. Thank you for that. And lastly, Lord, I just pray for the legacy of faith that we're all leaving. God, I pray for our kids and our kids' kids and our kids' kids' kids and God, I know the decisions that we make today are going to affect all of them. And I pray we live with the end in mind. And God, I thank you for what you're doing in our church and in our heart. That we want to finish and finish well. And spend our time and energy on what matters. I thank you for all those that served us tonight. From Daryl getting here early to cook hamburgers and the cafe team to the Kids on Master's Road team to John stacking chairs this afternoon and setting things out. God, I thank you for so many people who love you and love your bride, the church, and serve it. God, I pray, would you bring more? God, I pray for the people who aren't here yet, that will be. God, I pray you'd help us be a great witness for your glory and who you are. And they'd peek in, they'd see something about our life that would intrigue them. And we would be able to point them to you. And thank you for your grace. May we enjoy it tonight. It's in your name we pray. Amen.